might get into it at some stage if there's a bit more time going into the more mechanical processes of it. Like I say, it is time consuming. Please don't make any mistake about that. It's not something you just sit down and, oh, we'll just knock out a podcast in a couple of hours. And for me, living in Australia with so much action happening in North America, or indeed in the UK, it means my alarm goes off at 4 o'clock in the morning. I get my coffee.
Talk about that a little bit, because one of the big things you've been involved with was the AVN in Australia.
Yes, yeah.
See that slide that's been up there for all this stuff? The fight against them.
I can't. It's right there.
Oh, yes. Oh,
yeah, we can't see that.
Yeah. Oh, it's not visible.
It absolutely should be out.
You're not tall enough. Bro.
Yeah, okay, let's cover that.
Yeah.
What we're going to be talking about is what, in the case of the Skeptic Zone, one of the major things that we've been following or doing for years and years and years, probably ever since the Skeptic Zone began, the Australian Vaccination Network, or the AVN.
Now, they're not what you would think they are based on that name. Though.
Not what you think they are. They were founded in 1994. Under the name of the Vaccination Awareness Network, by a certain Merrill Dorey, who is
right there.
Can we have that moved out a couple of feet?
That
would be really cool. Because they didn't put up sort of naughty pictures of me, and I won't be up there. It's that picture, Jay. It's going to come back.
That's good.
That's great. There you go. Perfect. So that's Merrill Dorey. She's American, actually.
Yeah, she's one of ours, and we exported her to, like, cause havoc somewhere
yeah,
else.
Yeah, you send us Merrill Dorey, and we send you Ken Ham.
Yeah.
Somehow.
Yeah, we're good that
Jenny
way.
McCarthy
over there. Yeah, there's a balance there somewhere. So their basic underpinning, their philosophy is a deep mistrust of pharmaceutical drugs, and they embrace what they conceive of think to be natural health and healing, getting back to nature, is absolutely intertwined with the classic anti-government conspiracy theories, one world government, all this sort of thinking. Now, the group was known, I'm not exactly sure when they changed their name to the Australian Vaccination Network, but it's been their name for many years, until complaints from people like the Skeptics and other groups. They changed their name. They were forced to by law. The New South Wales, the state I live in, the Office of Fair Trading, which they come under this, ordered to change their name because it was misleading. I mean, I can't set up a pizza shop and call it a hot dog shop, if you know what I mean. I'm selling pizzas, not hot dogs. They were pushing anti-vaccination message, pretending to be pushing general information about vaccination. So what people, young mothers, young fathers, were looking up this information, saw Australian Vaccination Network and thought that's what the advice, they were getting good advice. So they came up with all sorts of variations, and the final name that they chose and was accepted by the government was, which they are now known as, the Australian Vaccination Skeptics Network.
So they stole our word too.
Well, it's a big dig at the Australian skeptics.
Yeah.
Because of our constant fight, and I might even say maybe even the Skeptic Zone, because we've been one of the voice pieces for the fight. And a couple of years before this, Merrill and her friends set up a website and a URL called The Real Australian Skeptics.
I don't have that.
The good. You can look that up, and it's like Scientology have these front pages that don't look like they're Scientology. And then it rants on about the fact that they're the real Australian skeptics, and these other people who call themselves skeptics or fake or pseudo skeptics. We get that all the time in the skeptical industry.
Oh, yeah.
People think that we're not real skeptics because we don't agree with them. Basically.
How many times have any of us been called a pseudo skeptic?
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
It happens all the time.
It's this equation that caused me to want to do a skeptic show.
I know. When
you see conspiracy nuts calling themselves skeptics,
I
realized we need more voices out there who understand what real scientific skepticism is.
Is it the Line 11 Truthers took over skeptic name?
We've heard it all. So where the Skeptic Zone podcast comes into this, and I'm sure most of you will certainly be familiar with the name of Dr. Rachel Dunlop. who's a reporter on the Skeptic Zone, who's on sort of on hiatus at the moment because she's, first and foremost, she's a research scientist, a biologist, and she's working at the moment in Wyoming. And if you follow her on Facebook or Twitter, she takes the most breathtaking photographs of the nature, birds,
and
mountains.
She's in Wyoming. Yeah. She's a cheating.
Yeah, yeah. In Wyoming, it's just out every window.
She's... So Dr. Rachie has now become a very accomplished photographer. And if you don't follow Dr. Rachie, I think it's just Dr. Rachie on Twitter, or you can look her up on
Facebook. She's won awards for her.
Yeah, she's won awards. Yeah, it's that beautiful photography. But I digress. In the years before she went out to come to the States to do her work, and she was a regular reporter on the Skeptic Zone with her report, Dr. Rachie Reports, a lot of those reports were bringing our audience up to date on the latest goings on with the Australian Vaccination Network. Court cases, what they're doing, what their blogs are saying, the people involved. It was extensive, and it's a great record, which of course is still there to this day. You can Google Dr. Rachie Reports, and she often put those reports up on her own blog, which is also the blog of the Skeptics and podcast called The Skeptics Book of Cuckoo.
She has the best blog name ever.
There's a story behind that too. And it was just really important to get to let our listeners know how we were doing in this fight against these anti-vaccination people in Australia. And I think it inspired a lot of people around the world. She was getting a lot of correspondence, and she became widely hated, of course, by the anti-vaxxers, which is a good thing, because it meant that she was doing well.
If you're a skeptic and you become hated for what you're talking about, that means you're doing your job.
Yeah, yeah, and she's on the bad list of the anti-vaxxers, big time. They referred to her by name often. They referred to me once as a mouseketeer, only evil.
Do you sing?
That's got to be a t-shirt, right?
I don't know if you sang.
What were they eating babies? I don't eat babies.
Yeah. Are you eating babies? I'm a mouseketeer, only evil.
Can you get ready?
So since Dr. Rachie is more or less on a hiatus at the moment, because her research is so important, she does work into motor neuron disease and all this sort of stuff, so all power to her, it's just fantastic. And the fact that she was on the Skeptic Zone doing regular reports for years and years is a huge testament to her. I have so much respect for Dr. Rachie on many levels. Now we have, I have a relatively new reporter, Heidi Robertson, who lives up in the north coast area of my state, New South Wales. You might have heard of places like Byron Bay. It's a very famous area in Australia for sun and surf and all the rest of it. But that whole north coast area was very famous in the early 70s. It was the center of the hippie culture. All the people who dropped out of society and embraced that lifestyle.
Berkeley. It's your Berkeley.
Sort of, yeah, but it's very regional. It's very in the countryside. They all went up to this north coast area of New South Wales, and they've got big, still to this day, there's a big hippie contingent there. As a result of the Australian Vaccination Network being centered in the same area, and this hippie culture generally, the little town there, where I grew up, as a matter of fact, just as an aside, called Mullumbimby, that's a great name, has the lowest vaccination rate in Australia, under 50% of kids in this little town and their region are vaccinated. Under 50%. It's appalling. So Heidi is our new reporter. Her reports go under the banner of the Raw Skeptic Report. I like to have little hooks. Everyone has their own theme music. People get familiar with it. It's all part of production, showbiz in a sort of a way.
But your show is kind of like mine. We're magazine shows.
Yeah. So when the theme music comes up for Dr. Rachie or Heidi, you know what's coming, and Maynard and all that sort of stuff. So she and her friends also started a group called the Northern Rivers. That's the name of the region, the Northern Rivers, because of the rivers up there. The Northern Rivers Vaccination Supporters. And they're doing tremendous work. They leave flyers and leaflets around and give good information. And they're, of course, in that area, in the heartland of the area, they're widely despised and hated. They get in the newspaper, they get on national TV. It's just fantastic. It's brilliant what they're doing. So I'm so pleased that Heidi Robertson is now a reporter for my show. and she reports on sort of taking up where Dr. Rach has left off for the moment, but also she does reports about first aid because she's a paramedic. She runs first aid courses, and one of her more recent reports on the show, a couple of, or maybe a month or two back, was on all the quack cures for burns, including homeopathy, which is just insanely dangerous. And indeed, one of the foremost homeopathy groups in Australia called Homeopathy Plus, who were sued by the government and lost, which is a good thing, recently put out a newsletter linking to a story encouraging people to use hot water to treat burns.
Well, that makes sense, though.
And to the skeptic, if people ask you about this or they complain, say to the skeptics, well, what randomized controlled double-blind trials have you seen using hot water and cold water on burns?
You weren't there, argument.
And it's like, well, what randomized controls have you seen, double-blind tests have you seen using parachutes versus shovels in the parachute backpack or something like that?
You know, Richard, the thing that impresses me so much about the Australian skeptics, you have a podcast, and the podcast started other activism. Like you're doing real world, not just popularizing science and educating people. The work that you guys have accomplished, particularly with the ABN, it's astounding. The legwork, the everything that you had to do off the podcast to get all that done.
That's true.
The thing is, it had the one advantage where your laws in your country allowed you to do things that we can't do here.
That's true, but I must say I am very careful. I am so careful. I know you are too, Steve, of course. We all are.
Not careful enough.
Because I need to dedicate my time and resources to getting reports, going on investigations, collecting all this stuff. If some quack or other was to do to me what would happen to you guys, I think I would have to fold the show because I couldn't fight all those battles. It would be too difficult. So I'm very, very, very careful indeed. But yeah, thanks, Jay, because it does reach a lot of people and I get a lot of feedback from it. It inspired other people to start podcasts, which is delighting. That's pretty cool. All in all, it's a pretty satisfying thing, except sometimes on a Sunday afternoon when I haven't got the show together and I know I've got to sit down for the next 5 hours and just do nothing else except put shows together. Or the alarm goes off at 3 o'clock in the morning because that's when the guy in the UK or the woman in America is awake, ready for me to interview them. Then it sucks.
Yeah, I think we all have that problem.
But apart from that, it's a buzz. It really is. It's something special.
And then also, not only that, you're involved with the Church of Bacon because of a recent thing that happened.
Yeah, Wells Fargo, when John Whiteside went in to get something notarized.
Well, tell us what the Church of Bacon is.
The United Church of Bacon is a group of non-religious people who are joining together to challenge the various ways religion gets special privileges in our society. That's one of the reasons that it exists. And it's a genuine church. As of yet, they've never taken donations. They haven't asked for a tax exemption or any of that. It's the only church I've ever been proud to belong to.
It's like the Unitarians take to the extreme.
Yes. It's kind of like the Woody Allen.
Now something happened with this in Vegas, actually, down the road. Yeah. With the local person here who did the legal notarization, notary stuff.
Yeah, he went in to get some notarization done on some church paperwork so that he could ordain someone to marry people.
Now, this has been going on already, so it's not like...
Oh, no, it's been going on for a long time.
Yeah, it wasn't the first person.
Yeah, if you want to join the Church of Bacon, there's no cost. You just say you want to join the Church of Bacon and you can be ordained. To perform marriage ceremonies and join men, women, or men and women if you want to be boring. And and so he went in to get this done, and they refused to notarize it. And he recognized that it was simply about the fact that this was not a conventional church.
And that's
discrimination on its face.
And then it led to you doing something here in Vegas.
We picketed and protested the Wells Fargo organization there. You can see there's Heather looking gorgeous, and David Silverman looking gorgeous. And we just stood up to this this discrimination. A lot of people of the libertarian bent called me and said, what are you doing? Don't you think that, because the libertarians think that corporations and companies and individuals who run these places should have the ability, the choice to discriminate if they do.
Yeah, we called that, you know, we had that same problem back in the 50s, I think. It was called the Civil Rights Movement, and the people said the same thing.
Yeah, well, there's, I don't make it that simple in my mind. I just don't see it as that black and white. You go back to Selma, there was a systemic problem.
Yeah.
Wells Fargo and people that do this sort of thing is not really a systemic problem. We can go somewhere else to get this done. I will tell you why I got involved in this. Not necessarily because I think that that everybody should be giving service to everybody when they ask. I don't necessarily buy necessarily into that. I got into it because there are laws in place that are supposed to protect religions from this kind of discrimination. Whether you agree that we need these laws or not doesn't matter. That law is in place. That's my thinking on it. And it wasn't being applied equally to a non-Christian or a non-ordained version of religion, because they weren't doing anything to protect the United Church of Bacon. This law was only it seemed like this law was only there to protect Jews, Christians, Muslims, those religions that are accepted. And that's why I got involved, because that is true inequality right there. And we have this acceptance of ideas, and we're not offending one another easily. We're really hard to offend. So I've only had a couple old friends that I've lost over the podcasts that we've done. One, James Inman, lost his mind, but he's just... James Inman, I grew up with in comedy, and he's one of these guys who really doesn't think clearly and thinks he's got everything figured out. He's convinced crop circles are real, and by that I mean that they're put there by aliens. Yeah. We all know they're real, but they're put there by
they're really there.
College idiots. But. And that's been admitted to and proven, and you can't convince some people who have committed their lives to reading every book on crop circles.
I have people who do it on my show.
Who do the crop circles?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm convinced there are just some people who hate crops.
A lot of times they get...
Occam's razor says that's what's at work here.
I found out during that show, most of the crop circles are actually... The farmers who own the land, they pay the people to do it because it brings people to their area so they can sell the crops on the roadside.
Oh, really? Yeah. That's an interesting conspiracy you got.
It's
there.
It's not a conspiracy, but they do it. And then and those people actually get hired now and then.
Right. Yeah. I'm going to have to see some evidence on this. I might buy into it. But, James Inman lost his mind after doing our show because... He had a movie coming out that he was part of called The Unbookables. And this is the first time anybody's ever done this to me, and he's one of my best friends for years. He calls me and says, you gotta cut out half of what we did. And I asked him why, and he told me that he was worried that by saying that he believed in aliens and that he was a 9/11 truther, that it would hurt the sales of the movie he was in called The Unbookables. This is a friend who doesn't think clearly. The movie, by the way, had no success at all, had nothing to do with that. And he was just losing his mind. The fact was, he was trying to find a reason to not go on a public show like mine and admit that he's that kind of idiot. That's really what he realized, I think, one morning after the liquor war. So, Yeah, I don't talk to Jim much anymore. Yeah.
Also, I don't have George Crabb. He should have been here. But, you know, the only thing I can talk about George is the fact that he's a close skeptic.
The question mark and the exclamation point make that for me.
Yeah, it's a cover.
Which genitalia does he have? Exactly. We can't be sure.
Yeah, this cover is tarot bag.
George's show is awesome because it's so intimate, because you really are creeping around inside George's head.
Yeah.
It's very different from the rest of our shows.
Yeah, it's not nothing like anybody else's show. But it is a skeptical show.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I wish he was here. He's here somewhere.
He will be. Walk up to George and ask him about his podcast.
Yeah. Also, he's the MC, so you'll see him. I hope. Somebody will have to do it if not. I was going to say thank you for attending, because, you know, it's the first thing on an IM, but we do have a little bit of time, I think. But
can I come to your bit of time?
Yeah, you can. Go ahead.
As I said, friends, that the Skeptic Zone comes out every week, regardless of what I'm doing. And just as an aside, a couple of weeks ago I had some surgery for some cancer, and you can look at my scar later, it's really exciting. But it was day surgery, as it happened. I was under general, and when I went home, and my good friend Maynard, who's a reporter on the Skeptic Zone, actually drove to the hospital and got me home, which is really fantastic. That night, I had an interview lined up with Randy, and I thought, well, it's Tam, it's Randy, this is the slot I'm voting for. So we did the interview, and I was slightly out of my head when I did the interview, because I was still recovering, but what I'm trying to say is, I don't care what is happening to me, I still want to get the show out. So I'll be doing a show at TAM. I might be interviewing some of you, I'll be probably interviewing lots of people running around. But what I'd like to do, with your indulgence, I'd like to do what will be the introduction for the show.
You're going to use my audience, are you?
Yeah. This is where you can really ham it up, folks.
I'll
do an introduction.
How do you feel?
And I need you to pretend that you're actually enthusiastic about it.
Remember, the slide says, especially at 9 a.m. on a Thursday.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so here we go. Hello, and welcome to the Skeptic Zone, episode number 352 for the 19th of July, 2015, live from TAM 13. Thank you.
Pretty good for IM.
So that's the intro. When you hear the Skeptic Zone
later
in a few days when I put it out, that will be the introduction. So there you go.
You're doing interviews for the show here while you're
doing that? Yeah.
All right, cool. We're doing, we have a podcast suite. We are up in 902, and we will be tweeting from Heather's account, Heather Henderso, on Twitter. Apparently there wasn't room for an N.
Heather Henderson without the N.
Yeah, Heather Henderson without the N at Twitter. Heather. Also, you can find us at Skeptically Yours. It's Skeptically Your.
Didn't have room for
the S.
Twitter
is all about restriction. That's what Twitter is all about.
None of your Twitter accounts actually have N.
That's right. And Ardent Atheists.
With an S.
With an S is our Twitter account for Ardent Atheist. And I'm Emery II. If you check into those Twitter accounts, you'll find out when we're doing shows. They sometimes pop up like that. And if you're available, feel free to run up there, and we will let in as many as we can afford to let in to watch the live tapings. We usually put about 4 to 6 shows in the can while we're here. I know that I'm hopeful that we'll have someone here, a guest who's coming to do a show for us. I'm hopeful we'll be doing a show midday, maybe 2 or 3 on Friday, is I think when we'll be rolling our first show. So check us out for that one. And we don't have to pre-record. You can scream, you can yell, you can interrupt our show. So come up and check it out.
I didn't really say much about my show, but one of the people who is often a contributor is this person back here, is Susan Gerbic.
Susan Gerbic. Yeah.
And if you don't know much about some of the really cool stuff she does the Grassroots Skeptics on Wikipedia, And I have no idea how she finds the time.
Well, let me tell you, Susan works her ass off. Can I say that at 9 a.m.? And gets. She gets volunteers. She doesn't work off of a budget or anything like this. She works off of donated time. And they work so hard at making sure that skepticism and secularism and a little bit of atheism are represented well on Wikipedia and represented honestly. So they do a lot of work going into websites and making sure that quack claims from the assholes, I think I can legally say that, right?
Yeah,
they make sure that those people are challenged on Wikipedia and they don't just have a pass to misinform. They also make sure that well-known figures in our community are represented well on Wikipedia. So if you can donate time and you're one of the wiki nerd guys or girls and you know how to work in that horrific realm of pompous choice making.
It's about the same as, you know, YouTube comments.
Yeah, well, it's worse than YouTube comments. It's guys who have never had sex going, I don't know if this is important enough for the world. Sitting in their mom's basement. So we need skeptics and we need smart folks to go in there and make sure that really good representation is happening in Wikipedia, because Wikipedia is the encyclopedia of now and the future.
Yeah.
So thank you right there. Susan, what's here?
Google prefers the results for Wikipedia as they pop to the top.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Can I say one thing?
Yes.
I don't know if this is on or not. Is it?
Say it.
That almost everything they mentioned during this podcasting, Ryan Bell, the Northern Rivers Vaccination Project, the Stephen Novella, Emery, Derek Colanduno, Skepticality, almost everything they mentioned on this panel, we have written or rewritten on Wikipedia. So if you go to Wikipedia and you look at any of the things they mentioned, that was probably done by GSOW.
Where can people find you?
Right here.
She exists.
Right.
Okay. Let me help you out a little, Susan.
Okay.
A lot of times, this ends.
A lot of times.
Sometimes things end, and then down the road, if they want to find you and reach out to you and help you out, do they email you somewhere, or is there a Twitter account?
Yeah, you can find me at SusanKerbeck.com. You could look us up on just about, we're everywhere. Just,
yep.
She's a regular.
Just use your brain, the gray matter, and just.
And GSOW, Guerrilla Skeptics, on Wikipedia.
And they
I'm
do
on
a,
Skepticality.
Yeah, you
I've
do.
Been on
they do a segment on Skepticality.
I've been on
episode.
SDU.
Yep. She's done our shows.
Yeah.
We all support her.
Very cool.
Thank you.
Well, we had a little bit of extra time because we were minus a couple people, but I have to thank you all for coming out. Having fun. Anything else anybody wants to say? Yeah, if you want to, do some QA. We have a microphone and we have a little bit of time. So, line up. All right, we're so boring, nobody's going to ask a question. No, everybody knows everything about us they ever wanted to know.
It's all on Wikipedia.
It's all on Wikipedia.
Thank you, buddy.
Susan did her job.
That's how it really works now. So, could you do me a favor and tell me how you're supported? What variety of ways you're supported in Australia?
If I understood the question, how am I supported? For
yeah.
Skeptic Zone? I rely on my team doing what they're doing because they believe in what they're doing, and they give their time and efforts for that. To cover costs of the show, I absolutely rely on micropayments through PayPal at theskepticzone.tv. You can. And people do, enough that it covers the running cost of the show. It covers things like equipment for myself and my reporters, which I give to them because they use it very well.
And you send them into a war zone?
When I send them into the war zone, they need that. and it sometimes it covers things like getting them to conventions and things like that. But it's really not a money-making thing. It's covered enough for me to do what I want to do, and my friends who believe in what we're doing to do it. If the micropayment stopped, then the show will stop. It's as simple as that.
Is that all from Australia? Is it all from Australia, or are you getting it all for the...
Oh, all over the world.
Oh yeah. I mean, a lot of people in Australia. Most of my listeners are in North America because of the population difference. Yes.
Most of our listeners are in Australia.
Let's swap listeners.
We have a huge Australian contingent.
I've heard that a lot. A lot of the podcasts around the world, skeptical podcasts, tell me.
US.
We get a lot from Australia.
Yeah, lots of people. Because Australia's got a tiny population. It's 22 million, I think. Something like that. But yeah, well, people from all around the world chip in to help the Skeptic Zone, and that's delightful. It's so nice, yeah.
So I have sort of a podcast-specific question. You guys all have different formats for your shows, obviously. I think, Emery, you guys are in the same room usually when you're recording. You obviously have reporters out and about. You guys, I think, are sort of remote, right? Can you just talk a little bit about that, about getting together over the challenges and benefits of how you do your show and how you work with other people in the show a little bit?
Well, just to start out very quickly, so the four of us, when we had guest roads, when we had, Rebecca was on the show, whatever, we're all in different cities. I mean, we're talking to each other through headphones, on Skype usually, or sometimes we have more people we use GoToMeeting or whatever, but, and then we're recording ourselves, and then, I do the post-production, I bring you all together. Yeah, that works perfectly fine. We're used to having conversations with each other, over the computer. You do lose the nonverbal communication, and so you do have to get used to that. You have to get used to doing that. And there is a lot of somebody asked me once, "How do you guys are perfect? You never step over each other. You always that's all editing. Yeah, it's all fake.
We're constantly
stepping over each other. I just edit it all out." And then we do, live interviews when we're in TAM and elsewhere. We do some live shows. We'll be doing a live show on Saturday from the stage. It's a totally different vibe because we're actually physically together. I get to see each other, I get to, know when Jay's going to stop talking, and then I could. It just has a completely different dynamic. It's much better when we're physically together, but of course it's just not practical to do that.
The difference is when we're together, it's a live performance, and we try not to swear as much.
Well, there's a lot of differences with a live performance. So live performances have to be much, more tight, much more to the point, shorter segments, and we have to be totally on all the time. When we're recording on our computer, we might say, "Oh, wait a minute, let me look that up," for 20 seconds or whatever, 30 seconds. Or we talk a lot to each other in terms of just logistically. It's like, all right, stop what you're saying. Let's shift to this or whatever. We say things that are just managing the flow of the show. Whereas on a live show, you can't do that. So it's all, everything is the show. So it's more challenging. It's two different skill sets, really. You're still talking about topics, but putting on a live show is very, very different than recording. But at the end, with the magic of editing, it all sounds pretty similar.
On our show, we do nearly no editing or changing of the content. We start the show with kind of the same opening thing. Earlier, Richard was talking about recognizing an intro and that sort of thing.
Your intro is impressive.
It is.
It's just insane.
Thanks. Well, we have a list of fill-ins for each week that we change. The names of the people, a few of the jokes change, but it's repetitive. I grew up with a show called Dick Van Dyke that I just thought was genius what they did in the opening sequence. And they weren't the first that did it or the last, but that one really affected me when he didn't fall over the ottoman after two or three seasons and he went around it. And I was like, I realized the power of repetition with shows of this kind. And so we do this repetitious thing with ever so slightly things changed in it. We're totally stealing the Dick Van Dyke bit, switch bit.
I never thought about that, but when you say it, I know
we're conceptually that's what we're doing there. And so it draws you in, makes you want to find the nuggets of change that go on with the same music. And it's really our show. I'm an editor, and I spend most of my life editing film, television, that sort of work. And it's just daunting work. So I decided to not bring that work into what we do. Now, Heather does a great job at editing the show, not in the way that you're talking about, but she takes the show's raw footage of what we've created, and she clips off the beginning. And makes sure it's clean on the, and then changes the levels because we recorded very low level, so you don't get too much of an echo in a non-studio setting. And so she does some editing work, but she doesn't go in and do the work you're talking about. We start that show, and when it's over, it's done. And if you said something that's going to get you in a divorce, you're fucked. I'm sorry. And that's another thing it brings to me. How do you not cuss? Like, I don't know how not to cuss. So
I used to be an actual radio, so I got used to it.
No, I did radio. I can.
Yeah.
Well, the Skeptic Zone, is, as I said before, is a magazine program. It has been from the beginning. The original 4 years or so, something of the show, I based it at 1 hour 20 minutes. I think that was because of asking you, actually. But then I realized that it was just extra work. So it's then cut down to an hour. Now it's roughly 45 minutes to an hour, depending. It's very flexible. And
1 hour 20.
And all the run of the show since the very beginning, I've had reporters, like-minded people, who have progressively got better at doing what they're doing. They'll do interviews, they'll sit down in their home, they'll write a very good report on health issues or something. They'll use one of the mics I send them, they'll read, they'll do a good read for me of their own work, they'll Dropbox it to me, the raw file, and then I get to work to do the edits. So I say to them, please don't worry about if you get halfway through a sentence and you stuff up and you get the word wrong, just keep going, start the sentence again, I'll look after all that editing work, which I do. It's a lot of work. And if what is bliss for someone like me is if I'm doing an interview, say I interviewed Jay tomorrow, and we chat for 20 minutes, it's a good solid interview. That's it. It's in the can. I can now plug that into the show and slot it in and away I go. But I've interviewed some wonderfully brilliant people who do fantastic work. But they speak this... Yeah. And
there's a lot of editing around that.
The thing I wanted to, and you have to, you, I really want them, their message to get out.
Right.
And they're fantastic people, but it takes so. And Steve, you know, it takes so long. When you finish that, the conversation is flowing, which is so important for the person listening.
Right.
And it's not the people's fault. Some people aren't an hour. So my reporters send me their material. I slot it in the show after I've done all the editing. And theme music comes up, their report, theme music comes down, a little commercial for another podcast or something, and then the next segment. But it's very flexible. So if they send me a report on homeopathy, I'll play that. The same person might go out then and interview somebody. Fantastic. That's their segment that week. It's an interview. It's a report on something. A couple of weeks ago, I went to an anti-vaccination rally in Sydney, and I recorded the lot, and I used that as part of the show. Here's my live on the spot report, and here's some of the crazy things these people were saying. So it's all that, but at the end of the week, when the show's going to come out, I have to sit down and put all these things together, string them all together, and all the edits and all the cuts, boil that down to one file, then process that, convert it into the correct MP3, upload it, and away we go.
Of all the shows, Skepticality and Skepticism are pretty much done the same one. And then different segments, and we have like one anchor interview, and then we have to do the same thing.
We
gather all the stuff. I got stuff from Susan and all people who contributed, and then I have to put it all together.
We discovered that we can't really do comedy well if we have Skype in, you had talked about. You lose that human interactive quality. And if you're doing hard comedy and people are interrupting each other and being funny, the timing is absolutely important.
Yeah.
And so we just stopped doing all call-in and none of that.
But you can fake the timing.
Yeah, you can fake the timing, yeah.
It's actually happened, not that often, but every now and then, like, somebody will think of a joke, like, a minute later. And then they ask me to clip it in, like, to make it look like they thought
right,
of it.
Right. You should do it. You're editing, why not?
Absolutely.
Nobody's going to ever trust your show being funny
again. Well, listen, the thing is...
You shouldn't have said that.
It doesn't happen that often, but...
all these skeptics are going to be looking for, what did he do? What did he do?
The results, all that matters. The thing is... I won't change the intent or content.
Sure, of course.
My goal is to just pack in as much good content as possible. Right. And the reason why I want to cut out all the ums and ahs is because that's time that we could be saying actual stuff, you know, during that 30 right. seconds. Yeah. So anyway, that's my ultimate goal.
It's also it's hard to listen to sometimes. It's really bad.
We do the micro payment thing as well. Yeah. The way we do it is, we had been doing for free an hour-long show. So to try to figure out a way to pay, because I kept getting more equipment that was just breaking me financially. So, and I don't want to try to make money off of it. You shouldn't be trying, in my opinion, if you're sending out a message like we are. You shouldn't be trying to turn it into a commercial endeavor, generally speaking.
You get yourself in trouble.
Well, then the guy who sues you is right. But
yeah, right.
The goal for us was we literally charge only $10 to listen to the 90-minute version of the show per year. That's a micropayment, like now.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a mini micro. But it absolutely does give us enough money to keep our equipment working and do all that. We also give away advertising. So anybody up here who wants to get their word out to an audience that might not be hearing them, and we do reach out beyond the skeptical community because we have these stars.
We all want our audience to listen to everybody else.
We give it away. Anybody who calls and says and is doing a skeptical or an atheist thing or a secular thing and says, I've got a thing that I'd like you to promote. It's on. We do. So holler at us.
So we've got time for one more question.
No check.
Sorry. She's serious.
I can't.
Yeah.
My question's for Dr. Novella, because I'm wondering when you win your lawsuit, if you'll be awarded costs, so you'll get your costs.
So, it's a complicated question, so there's different elements of it. It's not, the question is, am I gonna get my money back from when I win my lawsuit? We actually have already won an anti-SLAPP motion for the California plaintiff, of the three plaintiffs in the suit. So that means I will be getting money back for that portion of the suit, maybe 20% or so of my cost. There are a couple of other mechanisms by which we can get some fees back, the legal fees back, but though it hasn't been determined yet by the judge whether or not we will and how much. So by the present time, I don't know. It definitely will be something, because I've already won one aspect of it, but it hasn't been determined.
We'll be shocked if we get 50% back.
Yeah, I mean, if we get like half the money back, that'd be great. You know, we are asking our listeners to help with our legal defense, and that's the only thing that's keeping us going, actually.
So we're only going to lose like a house worth of money or a few college educations worth of money.
Yeah. Well, you'll have kids. Yeah. Just choose one not to go to college.
We just hope that it works out well in terms of that. But we'll be totally transparent about that. If by some miracle we get so much money back for fees that the money that was donated to our legal defense fund is in excess of our actual expenses, we'll just put that towards a science-based medicine legal defense fund. Because, this has already happened very recently, actually, when someone gets sued, they need like an immediate $10,000, $15,000 to hire a lawyer, put in a retainer in there, and just to get the process going. And then they may be able to shut it down, even if you have like an anti-SLAPP law in your suit. So we need to have a pool of money just immediately that we can mount a legal defense with anyone in our community get sued, and then hopefully that'll be the end.
This is a great idea. Yeah. This needs to be built and it needs to be in place, just like the $1 million challenge.
We absolutely need it.
Yeah, we need this. This is a great idea. You're building this.
We're building it. And hoping it'll be funded by hopefully the guy who's suing me. If we get
Well, thank you for
get behind this if you can get behind this. This is a great idea. Yeah. It was Stephanie Gutormson.
That's what I was talking about.
Is that who you're talking about? Yeah, the community jumped for her.
Yeah.
The minute this idiot went after her.
No, tell people who that is.
Stephanie Gutormson?
Yeah, because not only just a funny name.
Yeah. Stephanie works for the Dawkins organization.
Yeah.
And she had gone after, and I don't remember his name because it's unimportant. She had gone after this utter moron. of a human being that was obviously bilking people and making absurd claims that he could heal them, this faith healing moron. And she was making these wonderful videos, and then all of a sudden he decided to start arguing with her and then hit her with a slap suit. And she put out a Kickstarter of some sort, one of those, and started raising money. Does anyone know how much she raised? I can't remember.
$15,000.
Yeah.
My lawyer actually represented her at the time.
Oh, that's fantastic. I didn't know that. That's
all
great
around.
News. So this guy was really about to do to her what's happening to you guys. And so we got some money in her hands as soon as we could to give the lawyer action. I know that he charged her a lot less than he should have been charging her.
Friends and family discount.
Yeah. And so he took,
still a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot of money. It's a lot of money.
The novellas are already giving me all my money I need, so she gets it. Right.
But she knocked it. He knocked it down pretty quickly.
Yeah, but
right?
You need that $15,000.
You have to.
And a lot of people came because they don't have the $10,000-$15,000.
Right.
To just get over the first hurdle.
And what he's
that's
after,
what they're counting on. That's what he's counting on. Just,
what he was after was pull down this information that proves I'm an asshole.
Yes.
That's what he's trying to do. You have to pull this down. People are going to figure me out.
Yeah. What's really funny is, all these people, I just want to like train all the judges that the Internet Archive is there and it's not going away. So you can take away if you want, but it's all still there.
Yeah.
If you put something on the Internet, it's there forever. So it doesn't matter.
Well, but the thing is, that's an argument for paying them money.
The
thing
is, yeah.
There's no remedy, so I have to give them money. So That's not actually helpful. To be honest,
step away from the mic, Derek.
Well, that is all the time we had. So thank you so much for. I mean, we got a lot of people for the very first thing that happened to TAM this year. So thank you so much.